nice to be here. And interesting, Dr. Schaefer talked about my work with the TV studios and our newscast. And that's actually going on right now. We are editing and writing our production and the cues and all of that good stuff for our Wednesday broadcast. It will be newscast number 2 this semester. So you can watch us on KXVNO on Saturdays. Live on our digital, and I'm the shameless plug, right? But it is a lot of work, and the students, I hope, as their senior year, they do start to understand the importance of audio. With all my research that I've done, last year we worked on a documentary for class. I've worked on a few of those, but I did read from an expert, I can't remember his name, but it was so powerful because it's what I think all the time, but I just to hear it from somebody else was really empowering. But this person who creates a documentary said, people will forgive, an audience will forgive crummy video, but they won't forgive bad audio. And I'm like, thank you. It is the foundation for storytelling. If you are going to write a piece for a documentary or a news story or an entertainment story or sports story, you have to have good audio. So for me, it's something I've always loved. I've always been passionate about it. And I'll talk a little bit about my career here in a second. But I want to also tell everybody to let you know I'm also kind of this creative mind. I'd like to think I'm kind of like Einstein, except I'm not a genius at all. I just am. Got all these ideas going on in my head, and I'm creative, and I thought it'd be a really great idea. I love audio and video, right? And digital stuff. So I'm going to use Adobe to make a presentation because I don't like PowerPoints. I think PowerPoints are so old school, and put a lot of work into it, and literally over the weekend, and I didn't know how to make it work. So that's kind of a terrifying thing for somebody who's a communication expert to come up and admit, but I think everything is working. So it was my enthusiasm for new technology, though, that kind of got me here. So hopefully, though, you'll enjoy it, and we won't have too many issues with technology, because that is one of my pet peeves, is waiting for the people to run technology, and we're the experts. Anyway, I want to talk a little bit about audio, life's critical element, according to me. So I put my life into 3 acts. The first act is when, you know, before I was 16, I've always loved television and radio. And I was a total dork when I was a kid because I would watch the nightly news. And I remember having my mom wake me up to watch the first broadcast of Good Morning America. I can say I actually got to see that. I was like 4. But it's just been something I'm passionate about, talking to people about communication. It's just such a basic function, yet we sometimes do such a poor job of it. And now with all of the digital media coming out at us, that everywhere, at every turn, everywhere we're going, it's hard to, A, stand out. It's hard to understand what's real and what's not real. And sometimes maybe our voices just get a little muddled. But I started in radio at 16 in my hometown of Spencer, Iowa, where I was a DJ. It was an adult contemporary radio station. I read news, and then I picked up more and more shifts all the time, and I was working overnights during school. And then in the summer, I would work in the cornfields, and then I'd still go to my night job at the radio station. And then I went to Morningside College, where I was the general manager there of the radio station, the college radio station. And then I got a job in television, which is what I wanted to do, right? That was like living the dream. Well, only I wasn't really living the dream because I wasn't as fulfilled in television. And there's a long host of reasons why, but a lot of it was so based on looks. And I was covering, so sidebar a little bit, but I was covering a trial where 2 young folks had been murdered in Sioux City, Iowa. And I got in trouble because my hair was disheveled. And I said, okay, wow, I'm worried about these 2 kids that are dead and the murder going on trial, and I'm in trouble because my hair is disheveled like it is right now. So that was just an accumulation of things that I still love it. I still believe in it. I still have a lot of friends in the industry, but I'm where I need to be. I love teaching it, and I love learning the latest technologies and then sharing it with people who are enthusiastic about it. So that's my first act. And I guess I kind of went into my second act. So I was in television for about 4 years. And then I went back into radio. And I worked at a news talk, top hot country station in Sioux City for a few years before I moved here. I wanted to challenge myself, try grad school, not thinking I could ever do that because I wasn't the academic type. Came from a community in Iowa that, I mean, I shouldn't say it, but I'm going to say it. Meth was their hot commodity, right? You know, corn, soybeans, and meth. Big drug town. And so that's kind of what you think that you're going to be. You think, you know, because that's all you know. So grad school, I was so terrified, but I wanted to do it. So I came to UNO, earned my graduate degree, started teaching, and they can't keep me away. I love it. So leads me to the third act. And I've won some national awards. It's kind of embarrassing to talk about because I don't like to talk about myself. But I do want to talk about it because I can do it. But more importantly, my students have won national awards. Last year, we were in Las Vegas, where I had 3 students accept 4 awards. One was the Jamie Harvey was winner of all of the audio. And I can't think of what the name of that is right now. But they were portrayed on all the websites. And they won $1,500 and a Crystal Award. It was amazing. And we just had a great time in Las Vegas last April. And this has gone on since Matthias Jeske, which was about in 2015. So it's not that I just had this talk with the staff today. It's not about awards. Sure, they're fun. And it's kind of cool to receive it. But I also judge a lot of stuff. And I know how picky I can be. So sometimes judges are just looking for certain things. So we don't want to hang our hat on that, but they are kind of fun. Because it's an industry that we love and we're competing, and I like to compete. So much to talk about. Now understand, I teach several classes in audio and television and journalism and film. So to merge everything into one class, what do I hit on? What is the most important thing, especially music majors, right? You're all music majors in here? So you all, music of choice. What's your instrument?
Guitar.
Oh, guitar, awesome. I played guitar a little bit when I was little, but so cool. How about yours?
Also guitar.
Guitar. How about yours?
Guitar,
okay. Any saxophonists? Okay, all right, that's what I played. Love it. Love the saxophone. What else? With drummers? And then probably vocalists, live vocalists. All right, cool. Well, I love to have musicians and theater majors coming to audio classes is amazing because you have an ear for it already. You already have a sense of timing, a sense of pitch. And now it's just, hey, I might just get out of your way and let you just excel and do good things. And I've had a lot of theater, a lot of music majors come through my classes. And then, yeah, sometimes psychology, criminal justice, everybody and anybody can join MAV Radio. And that's the college radio station where I'm the general manager. And we are in a rebuilding year. So, you know, anybody want to come over and help us out? We have Evan is on staff. Hi, Evan. Sorry to point you out, but I'm going to. Evan does music for us, and he's helping keeping us current. At any rate, that's a little bit about me, a little bit about where I come from and my passion for audio and why I love talking with students of music and students of theater and students actually of any subject. So I want to share right now, this is literally just turned in I think last week. It's a student of ours, Jenna Jansen, who's doing stuff. She's just an ace at what she does. But this is our podcast. So it's the first year I've taught podcasting, but we've incorporated it in our courses, actually in my courses for several years. Now I think podcasting is kind of on the verge of, if not already oversaturated. It was so fun back in 2015 when I really felt like we can get out and make our points in our basement downstairs. But now we're competing against 2020 and NBC and PBS, Joe Rogan, all kinds of different money makers out there. But nevertheless, there's still room for why not you, right? So as I play this, first of all, let me point out that I am not a graphic artist, and this is the first time I had the students, I required them to use a graphic, because our graphic that I created for the thumbnail is lame. I'm trying to get better, I'm fast at it, but I'm just not that skilled at it. So this is maybe not the best, I don't think it's too bad, but Jenna created this, and again, some of the graphics that you'll see on here, like this isn't my forte, I just like to talk about music and vocals and audio and video. So what I want you to hear in this, and it's just a 30-second sample, it's her intro and then she goes into the podcast, but I want you to hear her vocals and her delivery and the rate in which she speaks. And then Jenna actually has a little bit of, she uses a different sort of inflection in her voice and her tone. And I love it. It's more character acting, to be honest, which a few years ago I would have said, we don't do voices, this isn't a voice class. Now, I'm all about that. I'm all about voice work. If you can do it and you can do it well, bring it on, because the more skills you have when you graduate, the better off you're gonna be. So you can listen to Jenna's voice, listen to the way that she takes music and sound effects and helps create this visual theater of the mind is what we in radio call it, but we're just using our ears. And I want you to just think about what you hear.
Welcome to Unraveling the Unsolved, where shadows linger and secrets hide. I'm your self-proclaimed detective, Jenna, and together we'll dive into the unsolved stories that haunt the heart of Omaha. Prepare to uncover the mysteries that defy explanation. This is Unraveling the Unsolved. Born on June 24th.
So that's just it. Sorry, just kind of cuts out, but it does. What'd you think? What are you feeling when you're hearing this? Anybody can just shout it out. I don't know names here, except I could pick on Evan all day. I don't think he would like that. So save Evan, please, right? Rick and Morty guy. Well, okay, no, somebody, okay, Rick and Morty, you talk, and then we'll go to Hat Guy, okay?
I know Jenna, so it's really weird to hear a character voice.
Does she do good? Well, I mean, weird to hear? What do you mean by weird?
No, just because I know her regular speaking voice better.
Yeah.
So it's kind of uncanny to hear like some of her normal voice still in the character voice.
Mm-hmm.
My throat just got that, sorry.
Well, it's okay. Yeah.
I think it fit like the emotion of what the podcast is.
Yeah, what kind of emotion?
Suspenseful, it's drawing you in into the bed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mysterious, like the soundscape.
Did it make you want to continue to listen?
Yeah.
So when it cut off, all of a sudden you're probably like, oh.
Maybe.
All right, I'll let her know that. You can catch the episode, and I was going to play it all. It's not too long. I think it's 5 or 6 minutes, but it's completely produced. And that is harder to do than some of the other podcasts that I've have done where they're just talking about a topic. So I was really happy with the overall production. And even better, Jenna is really happy about it. And you can listen to it on our podcast. Or what is it, Apple? I'm trying to think of how they say it. Apple, on Android, or anywhere you listen to podcasts. That's where we're at. And Jenna's, this was fantastic. All right, I could play that again, because see, is the technology thing. So I want to go back to why I find audio so fascinating. And what I will tell people is, my students in particular, but anybody who will listen, is that audio to me is just basic. It's so functional. It's so functional to who we are as people. Because storytelling really starts in the womb. It's the first sense said to be the first sense that we develop in the womb, and said to be the last one that we lose when we pass. I think that's pretty incredible. And I love the idea that we hear voices, are the heartbeat of the mother in which we are growing, the stories, the atmosphere outside. And through time, we've had, as you know, oral storytelling was told throughout generations. And then we had Romans? Where did I put it? Evolved into writing systems. So they were doing the hieroglyphs on tablets and stone walls, and they were starting to pass down information via reading. And we'll talk a little bit about reading versus auditory versus even seeing. But as somebody start writing things, hey, let's start singing something. All right, well, let's put together this, you know, piece of wood with some strings, start playing it. And then let's mix it all together and make something magical. It is a fundamental role in human culture, connecting through the shared experiences, emotions, and ideas. And I am almost 100% sure everybody in this room knows what I'm talking about, because you're music majors. If you haven't finished a piece where you're out of breath and you maybe have chills, then have you all felt that way? I'm sure you have, because it's just so powerful. Have you ever seen a performance at the Holland Center? It just moves your soul. I'm kind of like that. I mean, with concerts, I love concerts. I love live shows. And the really cool thing is I can talk so many languages when I talk music with people. And I'm sure you can too. And it just spans across civilizations for millennia. If we were in a different class with me, we could talk about that history, but we don't have a lot of time for that. So I'm just gonna kind of set, oh dang. That was supposed to come on during the, that kind of cool. So that's just a sound effect from Universal Production. I thought it sounded kind of, what did it sound like to you? Anyone? Gaelic? Maybe, I don't know. I just thought it was kind of cool. Anyway, so I added that, but that was part of this new experience with a slide deck. So I don't think I have any audio with this one. I shouldn't. To talk a little bit about the timeline. So we talked about millennia when we are growing and we are hearing, growing in the womb, we are hearing storytelling from our forefathers, and then we learn how to write. And then when did it really take off? Well, I mean, arguably the Gutenberg Press, and that was the Bible. They could now get literacy out to the masses. It still took a few hundred years to do that, but that was really the first sort of world-changing event that brought communication to the masses. In the 20s and 30s, though, radio became widely available. We could go back when it was invented, because I was looking at specific dates just to confirm. And yeah, there's lots of different dates out there, and it's subjective as to, was it Marconi, was it? So I just wanted to bring up the fact that really after the, it was during the war, actually, interestingly enough, Hitler used it very effectively for propaganda in Europe. Talk about feeling like Big Brother was over your shoulder. He would have a broadcast in Berlin, and he would be in Frankfurt. But the people in Berlin thought he was there, so it was pretty terrifying. So it was very effective communication for him. So that's the downside of it. The upside of it is we could hear what was going on in other parts of the world, not just our little tiny community. And I'm sure you've all seen movies and you've read history about War of the Worlds and gathering around the radio. Well, then in 48, pretty much after the war, television became more widely available. It was supposed to kill radio, but that never happened. They coexisted beautifully for quite a long time. And in the 50s, that's when we had color television. So that's pretty cool too. But then some of my data that I was looking for to get to the state that we're in right now, I was thinking of streaming versus digital streaming versus, you know, how did it really evolve? And again, there's a pretty vast history there with the internet. And it might be, I might be aging, I am aging myself, but Napster, does anybody remember Napster, LimeWire, where you're downloading file sharing for, oh man, I was up for like 50 hours straight. I should have known better, by the way, it was like 1995, I knew laws, but for whatever reason, I'm thinking, oh, this is okay, downloading everything I could. And then, of course, we have some issues with, oh my gosh, the band is right in Lars from Metallica, thank you so much, because they came out and they were suing people that were downloading their music. So what happened from that point to where we're at now? We get a lot of free stuff, right? I mean, people are saying, hey, let's leverage this, get my music out in front of everybody. And that could be an issue for radio, by the way, because you have artists like Eric Church saying, oh, we don't need radio anymore. And I'm saying, kind of do still, but that's really for the future to decide. I hope we still always need radio. How many people here, though, use their phone for music? What do you listen to, Hat Guy?
A lot of stuff. You mean like genre-wise or like?
Yeah, do you listen to music? Do you listen to podcasts? Do you
mostly
listen
music.
To TV, sports?
Mostly music, yeah.
Okay, mostly music.
I wouldn't be more specific, I don't know. Which
but tell me, okay, you can talk about genres.
Like indie, folk.
Well, oddly enough, that the research supports what you listen to. There are stations called Jack and Jill stations. This is kind of old, actually, but stations in bigger cities where they program, they found it through iPod listening, Zune, isn't that a thing too? That people don't just listen to rock and roll, country, hip hop, jazz. We have a pretty eclectic library. And so they were putting together music for the Jack would be tend to be the demographics of male in like 25 to 45. And the Jill was like women, you know, 25, 45, something like that. And I was, again, maybe I'm more sensitive to it, but I'm kind of offended by him because I would be listening and I would hear Don't Stop Believin' by Journey. And then would go into We're Not Gonna Take It. And then it was just all over the place. And I didn't feel like it had any segue to it. There wasn't really any art to it. Anyway, I'm kind of digressing a little bit. But that's where some of those radio stations started, because most of us don't just listen to one genre. I think it's pretty interesting because now I do a lot of my, I love football, so I watch a lot of college football, and I can watch it on my phone. As a TV person and as a radio person, that's a little bit of a drag because I really wish we still had the monopoly on it, but we don't. So how do we leverage it? Well, you can be like Herdat Sports. I don't know if anybody's heard of that, but Herdat is all online. And they're right here based in Omaha. And Anna Bellinghausen, a former student of ours, she is the sports director, and they're getting thousands and thousands of hits. In just like a year, she's grown it. It's amazing. That's where the future is. The future is all digital. But how can we still incorporate, you know, the music and the audio and that listener experience? So how did we get to where we're at today? I want to touch a little bit on the waveform. So how many people here at UNO, we use Adobe products? Should be on all the computers, at least that's what I'm told. Is it on here in the labs? Okay. So we use Premiere, all of them, Premiere, Audition, Spark, the graphic stuff. And this is pretty much across the board on any style, any sort of software that you use. There's a lot of free software out there too. But I do know DaVinci and Adobe are among the best for video and audio. And I've learned that from just conferences that I've gone to and research of my own, because sometimes I feel like, really? This is that powerful? Because I don't even use all of it. I use like this much of it. So it's pretty cool. But the waveform, have you all seen this? As music majors, I would think you do, or think you have, because it really is the electrification. Is that the right word for it? But when we talk about like voice and just hearing, well, it's not going through any machine. But once it does, then we have audio. And here, it's just a visual representation of sound. And I say a little bit about the horizontal axis and then the vertical axis, and what does it mean? Well, it just means you can see the properties such as volume, pitch, duration, and the frequency of it. And I'm not going to get into a ton of it because, again, for time's sake, but it's really important because this is the visualization of what I'm saying. Now, in this case, this is just an example of a current podcast that we just listened to today. And this is, I put bad example because I made it bad. And then we'll listen to Emily's good version of it. But
that's it for this episode. Thank you for listening. Until next time, bye everyone.
Now, why would I call it bad? It probably didn't sound too bad to you, did it? What did you think? Your music, folks? Didn't sound bad?
Sound all over the place.
Yeah. And not balanced because of the timing?
Yeah, and then just levels.
Mm-hmm. Some levels were a little wacky. She had to create her own sound effects, by the way. I don't know if it said that in the title, because I think that was actually the outro. But she's blind, so she's telling her story. And it's amazing, honestly, it's so amazing. But how could we replicate the sound of what does that sound like? Well, that's her walking stick. And I literally use my iPhone and the audio, because before I would be like, oh no, you have to have a soundproof area. I thought it sounds pretty good. It sounded pretty good. And then the other thing was her braille. There's a word for it, but it's like her braille keyboard. But yeah, I kind of messed them up on purpose. I had the tracks all over. I would normally say you fade into the voice and you crossfade your work. This isn't. This is very drop and drag is what I call it. Sound effects, VO, voiceover, sound effect, music, voiceover. That is not how we talk. That's not how we hear. So this, I think, is better. But that's not it, so.
That's it for this episode. Thank you for listening. Until next time, bye everyone.
So we have a longer tail on that, by the way, for editing purposes. And she picked out that music by Lifehouse. Usually I would say try to avoid audio vocals, but she wasn't fighting the audio vocal, so I wasn't freaked out about that at all. Does this sound a little better, though? Why do you think so, Tulsa?
It was
better. Yeah, and that addition of music. And I did that on purpose. I wanted y'all to recognize that music, as you know, really brings things to life. I think it does kind of mesh everything together and just makes it flow beautifully. But I also just drug some of the sound effects, made them a little tighter. They came under her VO. So it just made more sense. What are your feelings with the differences? I know we already talked a little bit about it. But any feelings of the difference? And it can be very slight, and I expect it to be in this class because that's what you do. You're music majors. You have a very good critical ear.
Mm-hmm. I felt like the typing was still a little loud, but I definitely enjoyed the music in there. It definitely like brought it all together, kind of within the sound, like this, like it was the feel of how she was saying it too. I'm not sure what the podcast episode was about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The tale was definitely a lot better. It made more sense. Because she'd be using the cane she walked, right?
Yeah.
So I feel like it could really use footsteps to kind of cue that. Because otherwise, the very beginning sounds like typing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually what I thought it was at first. So it's still a little confusing now, but the tale is much better.
That's really good to know, though. That's good constructive critiques. So good to know. Yeah.
I think the vocals place like within the sound effects as well. Like not just them playing one after the other. All make it seem sound like it was all happening at once rather than just like all that sound kind of put this like plus jarring.
Yeah, and that's how when people come into the class, that's kind of how we tend to start, because I think that's how our mind works. But as we evolve, then we progress in the evolution of like, okay, let's represent what we actually hear, not what we think, but what we hear. And this was Emily's first production in my class. I hadn't had her before. So we were trying to make the clicking go with the beats of the music. But sometimes you're on a crunch. I'm not gonna lie. We had to get it done too. But nevertheless, I think it's a pretty good example of showing how timing matters, how it's so important.
I think with it, like even being out of time makes it seem like less like. So if it's in time, you might think it's a metronome going or like clock going, but even if it's out of time, it might sound more like organic, I guess.
You're shaking your head. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Awesome. You all think that sounds...
Then you change it. Nothing.
Like, I thought it was a clock at first. Yeah. It's like, oh, it's a
sin. Okay. Oh, see, that's really good to hear. And to hear other opinions on it. And that's why collaborative work is so powerful. But that's good to hear. Okay, another example that I love. I just kind of want to allow you a chance to think about it on a different scale, because obviously this is not done by students.
New Line Cinema proudly presents A Little Holiday Story. One Christmas Eve, Santa Claus got an unexpected gift of his own.
What in the name of Sam Hill?
30 years later.
Let's recite the code of the elves, shall we?
Oh gosh, is that awesome? Because you just hear the beautiful timing of the music, where it just changes your emotion, doesn't it? And I don't know about you, but we didn't even need to see the trailer of it. We could probably all envision. We had a vision in our mind of what was going on, which I think is just so cool. And, you know, the It's Just Audio is me thinking I'm cool. Hey, let's add some animation to it. I'm super embarrassed about that. But I could do it, so I thought I was like a child. I thought, let's try it, her. But yeah, I have the picture because that's just a screenshot of Elf. So let's take a listen to this version. And this is the recut of it to make it sound a little different, and it's a parody.
Yeah.
Mr. Hobbs?
Go ahead.
Yeah, I think someone sent you a Christmas gram.
Excuse me. I'm here to see a Walter Hobbs? Dad! I walked all day and night to find you.
You look like you came from the North Pole.
That's exactly where I came from.
It's a little complicated, but it's nothing
honey,
that we can't handle.
Honey.
What?
He thinks
he's an elf. Okay, just from listening to the audio portion of that, what's the differences between the real trailer for Elf, the one they distributed, and then this cut?
This one sounds a lot more epic.
Epic?
Yeah.
It's kind of intense?
Yeah.
I would have said sinister in the background music.
Yeah, sinister and imposing.
Mm-hmm. Sounds more, yeah, like dramatic, and this one's just like a family Christmas comedy type.
It's all the same content. It's just different music under it. Just different timing. Slower music. It's that dramatic drone-sounding music. And I think it is so powerful. Because as radio artists, as audio designers, that's what we are trying to get our message across with the way we place the sound elements. So I didn't want to leave you with not getting to see it. So I actually wrote Sinister Elf.
Yeah, I think someone sent you a Christmas gram.
Excuse me. I'm here to see a Walter Hobbs. Dad! I walked all day and night to find you.
You look like you came from the North Pole.
That's exactly where I came from.
It's a little complicated, but it's nothing
honey,
that we can't handle.
Honey.
What?
He thinks he's an elf.
I'm sorry, what?
I was adopted, but you didn't know I was born. So I'm here now. I found you. Guess what? I love you! I love you! I love you!
You get the hell out of here. This is some kind of game. What, do you want some money?
No! I just wanted to meet you. I thought you might want to meet me.
You saw that guy out there? He's certifiably insane.
Looks like a Christmas tree.
He's probably just reverting to a state of childlike dependency.
What are we gonna do? We can't leave him alone here.
What he needs is to be nurtured.
They were just having a little fun.
Fun? So felonies are fun now.
Introduce him to Emily and Michael.
Go away!
Once he comes to terms with reality, he should drop the whole elf thing and move on with his life.
I can't go to sleep unless I get tucked in.
All right, let's get it over with.
I'm Buddy the Elf.
That obviously required some visualization, but let's talk about the sound design, even without the video, but the video is super cool too, and the edits are so good. But just that sound design, they're using what context matters, right? Because all these are clips from the movie, but you as musicians, as designers yourselves, tell me about it. What did you think was kind of magical about this? If it's magical, I think it's pretty cool. Anyone?
They were using parts in their sound design, like traditional like horror would be like high strings, like that, like the frequencies like get you antsy, or like upbeat, like
more. Yeah, and that rate. A little bit of, I think there could have been a little bit of reverb, flange type stuff, just a hint of that. But if you slow something down, it usually always adds kind of a creepy element. And then pluck in certain pieces that are out of context of the movie and look at the power of editing. It is kind of like magic. And not to get too scary, but as a journalist instructor, and journalism is my foundation, context is always so important. And that could actually lead us to the future. And I address that here as well. Okay, so I'll talk about that in a second. The future of audio, the future of communication, where is it going? But before I get there, how do we get some of these sound effects? Where do you get this audio for your audio design? Subscription services. That's what the School of Communication does. We have universal subscription services. So we pay for all of our audio. And I still think, in Emily's case, we still couldn't find, we have thousands and thousands and thousands of sound effects. Still couldn't find exactly what we wanted. So we created our own. So you can use subscription services. You can find stuff that's royalty-free online. You can get natural sound, record it with your phone, and then do some magic with it in post-editing, or create your own sound effects. This is where music majors, I think you have an advantage because you can create your own introductions, your own song titles, your own brand through music. Not a lot of people have those skills. So that dovetails very nicely into radio, television, and digital. So before I go, what is the future? I sure wish I had a magic ball and I could tell you what the future is, but talking with some experts, I can tell you what they think. But I liked this. This was kind of a hopeful quote that I found. So new instruments might arise, therefore the number of melodies might be finite, but that number is so unimaginably large that we are in no danger of ever running out of fresh music. Because you listen to country music and sometimes it feels like they're playing the same three chords, right? Talking about a country bar. And I love country music, so I can say that, right? But I thought that was powerful because I am a music lover. So I thought this was hopeful, that we are not going to run out of... There will be another Beatles someday. But what's next? So as you all know, AI is out there. And we're still trying to embrace it, because if we fight it, we're gonna lose. Think of Kodak with film. Kodak had the monopoly on film forever, and then they didn't go digital, and now where's Kodak? It's gone. But how do we use AI to our advantage? Some of the experts have said it will be the core of music creation. There could be AI-assisted songwriting and coding. Anybody, I don't know if you want to say that with your professor in-house, but do you use it to assist you at all now? You do?
How many people have written music using AI? Yeah, a bunch.
I think we should teach a course on it, to be honest. I think that would be really cool, because there's stuff I know I don't understand. I'm still really bad at it. I try to make the portraits of AI, and I still have, like, dragon teeth, and I don't do it very well. But I know they do deepfakes that can sound like the president and Trump, and it's hard to distinguish the difference between the voices, and I'm pretty good at that. And if I can't tell the difference, holy cow, it starts to get pretty scary, because there's the voices that can imitate you, and they call your grandma and say, "Grandma, I need money." That's been happening, right? So there's some pretty nefarious things that go along with AI. Virtual reality, 3D immersion, that's already here, but I know they've been talking about that at big conferences, global conferences. Like I said, it's been here, but we haven't used it a whole lot, where we're embedded in a city, like a war zone, and we have 360 views. I haven't seen a lot of it. Maybe you have, I'm just not looking in the right places. But I've also used Oculus, and I've been to Stone Temple Pilots concert, and holy cow, it was amazing. Not in real life. No, I'm just in the little pub that they're in, and I'm looking all around, and I'm immersed in this pub, and I'm watching the Stone Temple Pilots. So cool. Music algorithms as the ultimate music fan. So we see that with Spotify and other apps out there. It takes the algorithms that we like from music, and then it curates its own playlist for you. And then social media just continues. I didn't even really want to go there. That could be an entire 16 weeks. But new genres. There's talks of new genres coming out. Okay, cool. When I was in radio, when I started, we had top 40. I mean, you had the genres that didn't really cross over much. Now that's all we have. Like Beyonce has a country song out. Post Malone has country music out. But Taylor Swift was country and she went pop. So that's been happening for a long time. What's going to be the new stuff? I can't wait to hear it. Oh, this was interesting. I know I'm running out of time. But basically what I was listening to was artists talking about live performances are really where they will be uninhibited. So that will be, I think, live coming back. Unfortunately, ticket prices are skyrocketing, so crazy. But let me leave you with this, because I think ultimately the reason I love audio, video, music, it comes full circle. Okay, that looks terrible. I don't know why it's not showing up well, but you can still see it. For me, crushing when we lost Prince. Prince was my childhood. Purple Rain, I mean, I can recite every word to it. I still see him in videos, and I'm still sad because I grew up with him as everything in high school. And so my high school friends and I can listen to the albums, Purple Rain, all of his stuff, and we're immediately catapulted to this time in our lives that was just good. And then I have Toby Keith, who just recently passed, who, when I was in Vegas 10 years ago, I was by myself, I was alone, there was a lot of things going on, and I found the Toby Keith bar and restaurant, and that's where I ate every night. And I was like a guy on Cheers, where talking to the bartender, but I really felt like I grew wings there, and so Toby Keith was with me. And when he passed away recently, I literally cried. I cried a lot because I felt like somebody I knew had passed away. And then I found out it wasn't just me. Like, he sold now more than, he sold more music in the last couple weeks since his death than he did in his whole lifetime. And he's competing with like Taylor Swift and just amazing. So collectively, I'm not the only one in this grief. And I'm just telling my part of the story because I'm certain you all, as individuals, have your own artists and your own music that you listen to that really hits your soul. So that, to me, is the power of radio. And that's why radio, audio, music, all of it. It's a communication that we can share. And sometimes when we don't have things to talk about, it can be something that can bring us together. So I don't really have, I haven't left you with a lot of time for questions, but if you have any questions, you can always get a hold of me, jbrownlee@unomaha.edu. I'm over in CPACS a lot, but you can talk to your professor. But I really appreciate this time with you and getting to share my passion with other people who are as equally passionate, if not more. I mean, this is what you're doing and probably plan to do in some form with your life. These are some options, by the way. So thank you, everybody. Thank you.